Again, welcome. This is a special evening for me. My name's Paul Helmke, and I'm a professor of practice at SPIA, the IU School of Public and Environmental Affairs. Been here about a year and a half. Used to be a mayor of Fort Wayne, used to be a lawyer, used to run the Brady Center to Prevent Gun Violence. I'm excited to be back on the IU campus and enjoy not only teaching, but enjoy running, directing a new Civic Leaders Living Learning Center, Civic Leaders Center. This is at Briscoe. And one of the things we've done for the last year and 2 weeks with the Civic Leaders Center is we put on programs. We bring in speakers on all sorts of issues, educational issues, arts issues, political issues, gun control issues, and try to reflect all perspectives of these issues for the students that are in the Civic Leaders program. There's 66 students, all freshmen, basically all freshmen in the program, and they're represented here today mainly in the middle. I originally thought about doing this program for them and then realized that this is a topic that involves and is of interest to the broader IU community and the broader Bloomington community. And it's reflected in the nice audience we have here today. So thank you for being here. The topic tonight is Citizens Divided, corporate money, politics, and spending, basically. And we've got two people who are very well qualified to discuss the issue and are nationally known on the issue. And we'll have them introduced in just a few minutes. But just think about how relevant this topic is now. First of all, we're having elections, midterm elections, in about 7.5-8 weeks. A lot of people are saying there's about a 65% chance that control of the U.S. Senate will change as a result of this election. Elections, money that go into elections are important. I've run, if you count primaries, 10 times. Money is a crucial part of running for office. So we've got elections coming up. In addition, the United States Senate, actually I think this evening, is debating a constitutional amendment, not the one that necessarily that the Move to Amend folks are pushing, but is discussing the issue of the Citizens United case and the role of money in politics. And then, just because I like history, yesterday was the 50th anniversary of probably the most controversial political ad of all time. Anybody know what that was? The Goldwater, anti-Goldwater daisies ad, which ran only one time with the countdown with the little girl in the field and then showing the nuclear weapon going off. So when you think about the history of campaign ads in this country, when you think about the closest of the coming election and the importance of the coming election, when you think about what's going on in the Senate today, clearly the topic of Citizens United, the topic of money in politics, is crucial. We've got, it's great to have the Civic Leaders Center being the sponsor of the program tonight. Our co-sponsors tonight are the Law and Public Policy Program at SPIA. This is a relatively new program at SPIA that is actually a partnership between SPIA and the Maurer Law School. And we have law professors along with SPIA professors teaching undergraduates classes that will help prepare them for law school or for any other part of society that's going to be dealing with lawyers. So it's great to have the Law and Public Policy Program part of this. The Maurer Law School American Constitution Society is part of this. They're basically the progressive student law group on campus. I've been on debates across the country where they've been a co-sponsor in the past, and they're a strong organization. We had asked the Federalist Society, I don't know if anyone's here from the Federalist Society, if they'd be a co-sponsor, because usually when I've debated for the one group, they're part of the group too, and for some reason they didn't sign on this time. So you can talk to them later. But since they didn't take the fourth chair, we allowed Move to Amend of South Central Indiana to have a representative here too, and they're the other sponsor, and they're the local group working with David Cobb's group on the issue of amending the Constitution. So again, thank you to the co-sponsors. One other announcement, not only should you have your phones off, but afterwards we do have food outside, and you're all invited to the reception once we complete the program. Our format, briefly, is each of the speakers will give about a 15-minute opening statement. They flipped a coin to see who goes first. After they finish their opening statements, they'll have about a one-minute chance to rebut anything that they were particularly offended by or interested in the other person's comments. We will then have questions from our panel. Each panel member represents one of the sponsors, co-sponsors here today, and they'll address a question to the two of them, and they'll each have a chance to answer the question. Then we'll open it up to questions from the audience. Questions from the audience we would like to have reflected on the note cards that were passed out. So after we've done the opening statements, while we're hearing the questions from the panel, that's your chance to pass the questions in, pass them up here, and then I'll select the questions to read. We're doing that. I'm used to crowds screaming and yelling and asking questions from all over, so that doesn't bother me. But we're doing a live streaming of this event tonight. We're also recording this event tonight, and the only mics that are really working are the ones at the table here and up there. So that's why we're having you pass the questions in. The goal is to end this at 8:30, although if it goes a couple minutes shorter, a couple minutes long, I'm not going to be offended, and hopefully you won't either. But we'll try to keep this moving, keep this interesting. Everybody okay? With that, our first speaker tonight is going to be David Cobb, and he will be introduced by one of my civic leader students, freshman Bailey Hussing from Floyd's Knob, Indiana. Bailey.
It is my pleasure to introduce Mr. David Cobb to you this evening. David is a representative from Move to Amend, a nationwide coalition dedicated to promoting both economic and social equality and decreasing corporate power in our democracy. David Cobb himself was born in Texas and worked as a laborer before attending college. He graduated from the University of Houston Law School in 1993 and established a private practice in Houston. Afterwards, he became active in the Green Party, helping establish and maintain Ralph Nader's campaign for presidency in Texas, and became the general counsel for the Green Party of the United States. He ran for Texas Attorney General in 2002 and President of the United States in 2004, both on the Green Party ticket. In October of 2004, David was protesting the Commission on Presidential Debates for refusing to allow third-party candidates to participate. After crossing the police protest line, he was arrested for civil disobedience. Undeterred, after being released, Cobb successfully campaigned for a vote recount in Ohio. Cobb is a member of the board of directors for the Green Institute and the Sierra Club's National Corporate Accountability Committee. He is a fellow with the Liberty Tree Foundation for Democratic Revolution and a principal with the Program on Corporations, Law, and Democracy. Without further ado, Mr. David Cobb.
Thank you so much for that kind introduction. I want to extend a thanks to the Law and Public Policy Program, the Civic Leaders Program, the American Constitution Society, Move to Mend, and Mr. Bopp for engaging in a political discussion, which I think is critically important in this country. And I mean that very sincerely because I want to remind you what you already know. The United States Constitution begins, "We the people." Those are hallowed words in this country. They remind us that done correctly, we are sovereign, that we are actually in control of this society, that we actually have not only the responsibility, but the authority to decide how our society will be organized. So as we come today to discuss the Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission, I want to actually take a step back and say it's more than one court decision. I think that what we're engaged in is a fundamental conversation about who rules in this society. Is it actually going to be we the people? And by this, I mean all the people. Or is it going to be the moneyed interests? Because that really is the moment that we live in. I believe that we are in one of those famous which side are you on moments in American history. And that really is just that important. It really is just that critical. And so, as I begin, I want to be clear that I'm really only going to cover four big picture concepts in my opening remarks. The first is my belief that this conversation, this discussion, this debate, and it is a debate, but this debate is not a conservative versus liberal debate. I think this is a traditional versus corporate understanding of how our U.S. Constitution is supposed to operate. And I will submit to you that the plain reading of the Constitution, a fair understanding of how the United States history actually has unfolded. The founder's original intent is very clear that Move to Amend, David Cobb stands on the side of a traditional understanding of how a democratic republican form of government is supposed to operate. That'll be point number one. Point number two is to make sure to cover some very important key concepts that I think we sometimes forget. They are often called first principles. How is our government supposed to operate? Those principles I want to make sure we cover: democracy, the concept of legal personhood and what that means, the concept of sovereignty itself, and then lastly, what is a corporation and what is the proper role of a corporation in our society? And the last thing that I'll cover is to really underscore and dig in deep on how the founders originally intended the corporation to operate in our society, and ask ourselves, are we experiencing the type of political, economic, social system that we want and deserve, or are we losing our democratic republican form of government? And then lastly, a quick touch on the results of Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission. So point one, this is not a conservative versus liberal debate. In fact, it is really about whether we have traditional values or corporate values. And I think that actually the best source to look at the framing of this can actually be found in the righteous debate that actually was happening between Supreme Court Justice Lewis Powell and Supreme Court Justice William Rehnquist. And I know and have learned recently that William Rehnquist actually was at Indiana University in 1996. So how appropriate to be building that up. You see, Lewis Powell had practiced corporate law in Richmond, Virginia. His national client base included the largest corporations in the world. He served as president of the American Bar Association and was on numerous corporate boards. He was an active participant on Philip Morris Corporation. And in fact, he advised the Chamber of Commerce. In fact, he came to the court with a judicial robe presented to him by Philip Morris Corporation and a determination to create, quote, corporate rights. This, by the way, how do we know that that robe was presented by Philip Morris? Because it was revealed by the conspiracy and racketeering litigation against the cigarette industry that was successfully prosecuted by the U.S. Department of Justice and the state's attorney general. Not making this up. Now, while neither Powell nor the U.S. Chamber of Commerce disclosed at the time of his nomination, a few months earlier, Lewis Powell had actually privately outlined a plan for the U.S. Chamber of Commerce to take the lead in organizing corporations, and now I quote, for political power available only through judicial activism, and to deploy, quote, the scale of the finance available only through joint corporate efforts, quote, especially with an activist-minded Supreme Court, the judiciary may be the most important instrument for social, economic, and political change. The point I'm making, friends, it was a predetermined effort to engage in judicial activism to create the concept of corporations having constitutional rights, especially as it relates to free speech. On the court, Powell forged a shifting majority, including at times liberals and others. He called it, in writing for decisions in 78 and in 86, he created a new doctrine for free speech for corporate speakers. He created that doctrine through a course of multiple decisions. And with increasing aggressiveness over the next 2 weeks or 2 decades, large corporations and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce's litigation project, which is self-described as a brainchild of Lewis Powell, increasingly deployed this new corporate veto to eliminate state or federal laws perceived as restricting the power of global corporations. I want to underscore that. This is an example of local, state, and federal laws being overturned in the courts. That, my friends, is the very definition of judicial activism. And Justice Powell knew he was doing it. In 1978, when the court for the first time in American history struck down a state law on corporate political spending, this is the First National Bank of Boston versus Bilotti, it was William Rehnquist who wrote a separate dissent. The limited liability to, here's what Rehnquist said. The state, he pointed out, creates corporations in the first place and provides, quote, perpetual life and limited liability to enhance its efficiency as an economic entity. These properties, he said, so beneficial in the economic sphere, pose special dangers in the political sphere. This is William Rehnquist. And it goes on. In a letter to Rehnquist, Powell admitted that no prior decision has ever expressly recognized corporate speech generally as explicitly as my opinion does. Nevertheless, Powell asked Rehnquist to consider whether it is in the public interest to stand against the, quote, trend towards the proposition that artificial entities should be treated as persons for purposes of exercising and relying upon constitutional rights. William Rehnquist declined and declined repeatedly throughout his entire time on the bench. And I think it's important that through that decline, Powell's predecessor on the court, Hugo Black, had maintained as early as 1938 that, quote, neither the history nor the language of the 14th Amendment justifies the belief that corporations are included within its protections of persons. And notwithstanding Powell's urging, this was the theme that Rehnquist picked up in his Bilotti decision, writing that, quote, the 14th Amendment does not require a state to endow a business corporation with the power of political speech. Again, William Rehnquist standing on the traditional conservative understanding of what a corporation is. It is, in fact, an entirely consistent understanding of U.S. jurisprudence. And Justice Rehnquist also wrote, state law grants corporations special advantages, and states may prevent corporate resources from being amassed in the economic marketplace from attaining an unfair advantage in the political marketplace. And I could actually go on for the rest of my time quoting from Justice William Rehnquist time and time again, where he employs his fellow justices, he employs the American people, that it is illegitimate and inappropriate for the court to create a legal doctrine of corporate constitutional rights. And that brings me to the second big picture, the concept of democracy itself. You see, democracy from Attic Greek means demos, the people, kratia, rule. It means that the people rule. We have the authority to rule ourselves. I submit to you that how we handle political campaign expenditures, in fact, how we treat the corporation itself, is a political question. And there can and should be vigorous debate and even disagreement on that political question. But when we turn a political question into a constitutional law question, when we allow five members of the United States Supreme Court through judicial activism to overturn the political process, we have lost control of our own democracy. Our sacred right to self-government is lost through the judicial activism of corporations having constitutional rights, or money is speech. These are not part of the American heritage. These were court-created doctrines that are illegitimate. And the next topic of legal personhood. Folks, please understand that we're not talking about personality merely for jurisdictional purposes or for the purposes of suing or being sued. We're talking about whether a corporation is a person with constitutional rights. You see, every single one of you in this audience, every single one of you watching this debate, every single human being actually has inherent and inalienable rights. It means that the government may not infringe upon the exercise of our rights. I have a right to free speech. I have a right to worship as I please. I have a right that cannot be infringed by the political process. My rights are not dependent on whether or not you politically agree. That does not matter, but here's the thing. A corporation is an artificial entity. It is created under state law. In fact, it requires a charter issued by the state government in order to even come into being. A corporation, as we know from first year law school, as we know the first time you take a corporations class, a corporation is a construct. It is only what we the people say it will be, and nothing more and nothing less. So to imbue legal personhood to an artificial entity is, as William Rehnquist said, to confuse metaphor with reality. The next topic that I want to make sure we cover is sovereignty. You see, sovereignty is super important because it actually means the authority to rule. And I submit to you that if we, the people, are actually going to be sovereign, we cannot allow money to rule over us. And I know what you know, what 80% of the American people know, and that is because of the Citizens United decision and before that, the Buckley versus Vallejo and First National Bank versus Bilotti, what we have seen in this country in my lifetime is we are turning elections into auctions. We are actually no longer involved in a conversation politically where we, the people, are actually debating amongst ourselves, and there should be debate. There should be rigorous debate about these sorts of things, but those are political questions. They're not constitutional law questions. When the U.S. Supreme Court illegitimately says corporations are persons with constitutional rights, illegitimately says money is speech, they've just turned a political question into a constitutional law question, which is to say they have turned we, the people, from active participants into mere spectators, where they tell us how our government is going to be funded, they tell us how our government is going to operate. They are turning us into sheep. And if we allow it, friends, that's our fault. And the last topic that I want to cover in terms of key concepts is the idea of the corporation itself. You see, a corporation, as I say, is a concept. It is a construct. And basic corporations law, for those of you who have not gone to law school, let me tell you the founder's original intent of the corporation. To create a corporation in the founder's era for the first 100 years of this society and this country, it took an act of legislation. Your application went to the State House of Representatives, where they debated it, discussed it, and voted on it, and you had to get a majority vote. And then it went to the state Senate, where they discussed it, debated it, voted on it. You had to get another majority vote. And then the governor had to be willing to sign it. You see, the founders understood that the limited liability that they were granting was a privilege, not a right. And the privilege was restricted in time. No corporate charter lasted more than 10 to 20 years, the basic lifespan of a merchant. Oh, and by the way, they were limited in what they were allowed to do. Any corporation that did any business other than that, what they were specifically allowed to do was called ultra vires, in Latin, beyond the authority. They were not authorized to do it. That means I've got 1 minute. Thank you, James. So, Paul, my apologies. I'm surrounded. Here's the thing, folks. The results of Citizens United, actually, I got to thank Citizens United versus FEC because they've actually united the citizens of the United States in a way I've never seen before. 80% of the American people are opposed to this ruling, and Move to Mend is getting larger, stronger, and better organized every day. We were 12 people in a living room in 2010 when that decision was issued. Today, we're 367,000 and growing. We're getting larger every day, and I want to invite you to join us. Thank you.
Our next speaker will be introduced by Maria Halloran, who is a freshman from Bloomington, Indiana. Maria.
Tonight, we will also be hearing from Mr. James Bopp, Jr., who will be defending the ruling of Citizens United versus the Federal Election Commission. James Bopp is a Terre Haute native who received his bachelor's degree right here at Indiana University and his law degree from the University of Florida. Throughout Mr. Bopp's career, he has acted as a legal representative for many high-profile conservative groups around the nation. Just a few of his major clients are the National Organization for Marriage, the National Right to Life Committee, Focus on Family, Susan B. Anthony List, All Children Matter, the Libertarian Party, and the Republican National Committee, where he served as Indiana National Committee Man for 6 years and Vice Chairman for 4 years. He has also represented the state Republican parties of Alabama, Indiana, Michigan, Minnesota, Rhode Island, Texas, and Vermont. James Bopp has had a profound impact on many of the issues he has represented in court, and even earned a spot in 2013's list of 100 most influential lawyers in America. Bopp has won 9 out of the 13 cases he has argued in front of the Supreme Court, and arguably the most visible of these cases remains Citizens United,
Citizens United versus the Federal Election Commission. The outcome of that case has radically changed the United States legal system's approach to campaign financing, as we heard. And since 2010, Mr. Bopp has defended the Supreme Court's decision in the Citizens United case countless times, arguing that corporations and labor unions have the same constitutional right to free speech as individuals. His work on campaign financing and other controversial issues have gained him the reputation for being one of the most prominent legal minds of the conservative right. It's my pleasure to introduce Mr. James Bopp.
Thank you all very much. It's a pleasure to be back to my alma mater. And I first wanted to recognize a few people that are here tonight who played a really important part in my upbringing and my time at Indiana University and my early practice. Paul Helmke and I were classmates. He was kind enough not to mention that in 1969, I was president of the student senate, he was vice president of the student body, and he beat me for president of the student government here at IU. I was way too conservative, and he fit the times as the voters overwhelmingly demonstrated, much better than I did. Also, Judge Ted Najem is here, who preceded Paul as president of the student body here at IU, and I was very pleased to serve in the student senate and to support Ted in his run for president. And Don Johnson, who's known as to many of you as the sponsor of the American Constitution Society, when she and I were young litigators, we found ourselves on the opposite sides of several cases over the years, and very pleased to see her as well. Yes, there's no doubt that what we are talking about here is fundamental to our government and how citizens are going to be able to participate in that government. And of course, in many countries of the world today, and certainly in all countries prior to the founding of our country, this meeting that we are having here today would be illegal. And you and I would be quite likely the victims of a police raid. Probably the American Constitution Society would be found to have been a subversive group. Because we are advocating political change and we are criticizing the government, we would all be liable to punishment. Historically, the people who have criticized governments have been arrested, they've been imprisoned, they've been murdered. In countries today, they are beheaded. And before we had separation of church and state, of course, they were condemned to hell. After separation of church and state, they were just arrested, imprisoned, and murdered. So that relationship is what is at the heart of the First Amendment, because it was a radical idea at the time of the founding of our country. That the citizens would participate in their own government, that it would be an act of self-government, that we would select representatives of the people to exercise only that governmental power that was granted to the government by the consent of the governed, and that the people would enjoy inherent rights. The most important democratic rights are found in the First Amendment. And that is, in order for citizens to be able to freely participate in their government, there were, as the court has said, four indispensable democratic freedoms that had to be, that they felt needed to be guaranteed in the Constitution in order to preserve those rights for the people. And that is speech, press, assembly, and petitioning the government. Arguably all four of which we are exercising right now in the assembly that we have here today. They knew, of course, that governments have always claimed the right and historically had the right to decide when and if citizens were going to be able to criticize the government, when and if they were going to be able to seek change in the government. And they knew that unless they put that in the Constitution for our government, that we would see the erosion of those rights. Because incumbent politicians, you know, they're human, they can't help themselves. They don't like to be criticized, and they'll use governmental power against anybody that would criticize them if they can't. Well, but there's also people that believe that, you know, in the government, that they believe that the government is smarter than the people. They're more wise, they're more, they're in a better position to decide, you know, every question known to man, that the government is better to decide those questions than the people themselves in exercising their own freedom. And so and there's no question that liberals, progressives, socialists, communists, all sorts of isms like that, that have monarchs, all agree for many questions, if not all questions, the government is the best source for decision-making as opposed to the people. And, of course, that makes criticism of the government illegitimate. If the government knows what's good for us, who are you and I to question that authority? And for those that believe in government deciding all our, what health care we're going to have and what light bulbs we can buy and what kind of cars we can drive, you all that believe in that, of course, also would readily support this amendment, as would, of course, King George III. I mean, he would just be lining up here and with all his minions saying, well, of course, we need to pass an amendment to this terrible Constitution that says that the people can criticize me. And I'm a king. You know, I'm the government. Who are you citizens to do that? And of course, the amendment that they support, and many of these forums do the same thing, I mean, the central part is, and it's in one sentence here. Federal, state, and local government shall regulate, limit, or prohibit contributions and expenditures, including a candidate's own contributions and expenditures. Now, contributions, we have an idea about what that is. You're giving money to somebody. And we have an idea that when you're given a campaign contribution, it's for a campaign, for an office. But, you know, what about expenditures? Well, even in this amendment, they define this to be, quote, to influence in any way the election of any candidate for office. Well, influence in any way. We're doing that right now. I mean, people are advocating different positions on something that's going to be voted on tomorrow. And arguably, those that take the pro side of stripping the freedoms from the people and giving it to the government on whether or not they can speak out about the government, arguably they're involved in even a partisan enterprise, because at least so far, only the Democrats in the Senate are supporting an amendment that would accomplish all of that. And think about all the things that people do to influence the election, the election of any candidate for public office. I mean, there's obvious things like editorials in newspapers, but there's less obvious but just as profound, such as the front page articles in many newspapers. It can be any casual conversation that you have, any letter to the editor, any meeting that you have, or coming together to talk about the government and what the government is doing to us or for us in office. I mean, it's really absolutely unlimited what to influence an election in any way is. So talk about, giving vast governmental power, vast power to the government to decide when they're going to prohibit people from talking about the government, because that in some way or another might influence an election. Very profound switch in authority. That goes really to the fundamental heart of the founding of our country and our concept of the, of our country, of a country of self-government, and not the where we are to tell the government what to do, not the government is going to tell us when we can talk about them, or when we can write a letter about them, or talk to our neighbor, or come together in this meeting. What government did we have to go to meet here tonight? No government did we have to go to meet here tonight. With this amendment, why wouldn't there be a government that we'd have to go to justify why this isn't subversive? You know, when you look at the history of our country, you can see how the founders were right. I mean, even in the face of the First Amendment, which says, it's amazing how you can have these discussions and nobody ever quotes the thing. Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or of the right of the people to assemble or to petition their government. Now, no law, I think they literally meant no law, or at least except in the most extreme circumstances could there be a law. But, you know, the government and the incumbent politicians have had the same problem with the word no as my daughters did when they were growing up. You know, they always thought no meant, sure, Dad, it'd be okay this time. Well, I think it was intended not to be okay any time, to abridge the rights of the citizens to speak about the government, to criticize the government, to come together, assemble, associate together, or tell the government that they're wrong and they ought to change their policies, just what this organization is doing, just what they're doing. But, you know, they want to pass an amendment where they're going to have to go to the government, get permission to propose to the government an amendment like this. Or the government just might outlaw it outright and throw these people in jail for proposing it. I mean, these things are not wild and crazy. These things have happened in every country in the world. It even happened in our country. I mean, the ink was not dry on the First Amendment until the Federalist Party of John Adams, fearful of the emerging party of Thomas Jefferson, the Democrat, the Republican Party of Thomas Jefferson, passed the Alien and Sedition Act, which made it a federal crime with jail time if you would hold the government in disrepute or any of its officers. Well, criticizing them, saying they're doing, you know, bad things, wrong things, is holding them in disrepute. So when people criticize John Adams or the Federalist Party who controlled the Congress, they got prosecuted. There were people prosecuted, convicted, and went to jail in our country in the 1790s because they criticized the Federalists and John Adams. Well, they were trying to hold off Thomas Jefferson, didn't work. Usually these things don't work, at least in our country. And Jefferson got elected, the Republicans took over the Congress, they repealed the Alien and Sedition Act, he pardoned these people who were criminally convicted for holding the government in disrepute, and so we move on. We move on to 1918, when fearful of communists speaking out in our country, Congress passed the Sedition Act, which was very similar in phraseology, which was targeting communists. I mean, that was the justification or the explanation, but it applied to everybody. It didn't say communists couldn't hold the government in disrepute. It said anybody. I'm sorry, I'm going to have Gret. Could I have your... Well, that didn't last past the 20s, and it too got repealed. But then, of course, we then had Nixon had his enemies list, and he sicked the IRS and other governmental agencies on his enemies. Clinton had 1,000 FBI files illegally in the White House. I'm sure of his political opponents, I really doubt that he's going to send them, you know, like a birthday card and wish him best wishes. He had something in mind for them. And, of course, we've seen now Obama administration pursuing the enemies of the state, as they would view it, the Tea Party, and sicking the IRS and on them to prevent them from functioning and operating. So there's been a real need for this First Amendment. And it's gone across political lines. There's bipartisan disrespect for the First Amendment. Because even if you're, you know, not a fan of government, even if you don't think government ought to be making all the decisions, there's another human emotion, which we've heard here from Mr. Cobb, which is, there are voices we just don't want to hear from. There are people we think are enemies. These are bad people, corporations. These are bad things that do bad things in our country, like have the audacity to want to speak out, right? And of course, what is the natural human emotion? Is to shut them up, isn't it? Shut them up and shut them down. Let's go get the government and let's go after them, right? Well, of course, you have to look at, we have such a short history in our country, but even there we have seen, you know, one side or the other, government, take over the government and try to use governmental power to attack their enemies, shut them down, punish them, sick the IRS on them, whatever they can do to run these enemies of the people out of our political system. Well, of course, the problem is, I'm sorry, I didn't know you. So I will wrap up. Sorry, I didn't see him. So in other words, the First Amendment is for all of us, for all time. In other words, when these natural human emotions come along and our response to voices that we don't want to hear, people that we don't want to be talking about, things that we are interested in, people that disagree with us, when we have that natural human emotion, all right, we want to shut them up, and by God, if I'm, you know, got governmental power, I'm going to use the government to shut them up. That's what the First Amendment stands in the way. It protects liberals, it protects conservatives, it protects moderates, it protects all of us. It protects those of you who are here just to find out what this is about. Because otherwise, you could very well go to jail because you appeared at this meeting. And that is not the type of country I'm looking forward to living in. Thank you.
We'll now give David Cobb a chance for a brief rebuttal, and then Mr. The Jim Bopp a chance to rebut that. And then we'll go to the questions from the panel and questions from the audience. So.
Oh, I'm sorry. You can't hear me? Money is not speech, it's property. Money can be used to amplify speech, and if we allow the wealthy to have the ability to overwhelm the political discourse, we can't have discussion and debate. Now, I clearly disagree with many of the ways Mr. Bopp has phrased what I'm for, and I'll speak for myself and would respectfully ask him no longer to put words into my mouth. I'll speak for myself. But I will tell you this, it's very clear to me, and I think to the overwhelming number of Americans, that we're fast losing control of our democratic republic. That we are fast allowing a small wealthy elite to literally control this country. And I think that that's really, at essence, what I and we at Move to Mend are most concerned about. And I'll point out that there was never, during the 15 minutes, any conversation around why an artificial entity known as a corporation should have constitutional rights. Not once. wants a conversation around the founder's original intent on how corporations would operate, nor was there an acknowledgement that for over 150 years in this country, it was well understood that campaign finance laws were political discussions. And this was a function of the Democratic-Republican political process. Again, when the court overturns a democratically enacted law that goes through a political process, that is judicial activism. And I'll be clear, I do believe that any time a human being's constitutional rights to speak or to assemble or to practice religion or any of the inherent human constitutional rights are ever challenged or restricted by government, it's the authority, it's the right of we the people to have that law overturned because it's an illegitimate exercise of the political process. But campaign financing is a political question, not a constitutional law question. Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you, David, for the invitation. Corporations were very rare at the founding of our country, and even at the turn of the 1900s, when the first law was passed to limit their participation, there were very, very few corporations. Of course, that has completely changed. Every mom and pop grocery store is a corporation, gas station's a corporation, law firm is a corporation. And every advocacy group, I'll bet the American Constitution Society is a corporation. Yes. Don says yes. So when we're talking about corporations, don't forget we're talking about the American Constitution Society. I'll bet Democracy Unlimited is a corporation. I'll just bet. Okay. Well, when we're talking about corporations, we're talking about a very convenient vehicle that allows people to organize together, to work together. In other words, instead of acting as an individual, it provides a mechanism where people can associate with each other and work together, pool their resources, pool their time. And every advocacy group that I know of is a corporation. And because it's a very useful vehicle to accomplish group activity. So when somebody looks at a corporation, particularly advocacy groups, but also business corporations, that's the way I look at them. I look at them as a collection of people who have come together to work together toward a common goal, and that a corporation is a way, a mechanism, for them to organize themselves to effectively pursue that. Now the idea that corporations have rights or corporations are persons is really not anything new. I mean, this has been recognized for decades. And the most famous case is New York Times versus Sullivan, where the New York Times was being sued for defamation, and they wanted to defend on the basis that they had a First Amendment right should be protected, and that they had to have a higher standard for defamation than just what you and I would do between the two of us as far as it relates to politicians. In other words, you should be able to criticize them without being sued for defamation. Well, the first thing the court had to say is, were they a corporation or not? And they said, whether they were a 14th Amendment person, and they said, yes, they were, therefore had the First Amendment right to speak, and so therefore their criticism of public officials was protected. So, of course, that example tells us what money has to do with all this. Somebody had to buy the first soapbox, somebody had to buy the megaphone.
So there is a home team advantage, I understand that, but there is a timing.
We're at the 3-minute mark.
Okay.
So, yeah. We'll have plenty of time and other questions here.
Right.
So, okay. The... At this stage, and I'm a very generous moderator, we're going to take questions from our panel, and our first question will be from David Vornholt. David is one of the freshmen in the Civic Leaders Program from Danville, Illinois. David.
Thank you. An argument for corporations is that the owner's rights pass on to the corporation, similar to the Hobby Lobby case. So where or how should the government draw the line between solely human rights and rights that pass down to the entity, if it should even be attempted?
Well, and I'm give each side 2 minutes, and we'll start with Jim.
Okay. Okay. Actually, the court has been involved in that discussion for decades. In other words, what we're talking about here is 14th Amendment personhood, because unlike the First Amendment, which says there shall be no law abridging speech, so it doesn't give the right to speak to somebody, you know, like a person, a citizen, or whatever. It protects speech as an activity. No matter whoever can do it, they get their speech protected. 14th Amendment says confers on persons the rights of due process and equal protection. And so the question has been, that the court has dealt with, is whether all of the Bill of Rights ought to apply to anybody that's recognized as a person, and they recognize children, illegal aliens in the United States, women before they had the vote, all sorts of things. Partnerships are recognized as persons, but they don't enjoy every right, the Bill of Rights, because some are considered personal enough. I don't see where speech or political participation is of that nature. Corporations are being taxed, and and these are people that have come together to make a profit, and of course their profit's being taxed. Why shouldn't their speech be as equally welcomed and listened to as any others?
So I think it's a very important question, and I appreciate it because it goes to the very core. You see, I am a civil libertarian, and I absolutely believe that a human being's rights are inherent. They are inalienable. The Constitution doesn't create these rights. The Constitution recognizes them because we are persons. And let's also acknowledge something else, that from the founding of this country, only about 5% of the human beings were actually persons. It actually took social movements in this country, the abolition of slavery, the women's suffrage movement, the trade union movement, the civil rights movement. You see, it took social movements to actually grapple and drive actual human beings into the Constitution. Isn't it interesting that the whole concept of a corporation being a corporation or being a person with constitutional rights was created like that by 5 members of the U.S. Supreme Court in judicial activism? Really want to underscore how illegitimate that is, and then get to the very essence of what I understand your question to be, and that is, no human rights can be imbued to an artificial entity, because the reason we have those rights is because we're human, because we have hearts and minds and thoughts and feelings. That's actually the whole essence of human rights. A corporation, whether it's for-profit or non-profit, a union for that matter, none of these entities have those inherent and alienable rights. So I would say none of those rights imbue to the corporation. However, it is true that there may be issues of standing where the artificial entity is merely the correct mechanism to allow my inherent and alienable rights or some other human rights to actually be protected. So it's a standing issue that I believe that you're actually asking, and that's what actually has been litigated time and time again in the courts.
Okay. Thank you both.
The second question will come from Ari Hoffman, who's a sophomore in SPIA's Law and Public Policy program from Lincolnwood, Illinois. All right.
Thank you. My question is this. To what extent do you both believe that campaign finance actually influences who wins elections? And how strong do you believe the correlation is between the candidate who has the most funding and the candidate who ends up winning?
Well, I mean, it's not just my opinion. It's objective scientific data. And if we have any political scientists or social scientists in the crowd, I'm sure that they can actually point to the fact that it is the single best predictor of who is going to win an election, bar none. I mean, there is no other variable that will most correctly predict who has actually won an election. So I think it's very clear, and this is the reason. It's not because that money has somebody changed somebody's mind per se. It is the psychology of how the process works. The relentless campaigns and 30-second ads that can actually flood out any other discourse. And let's be honest, these 30-second ads, whether it's for a candidate you like or don't like, it's so much sound and fury signifying nothing. No
political discourse is actually happening. And this is the thing, even though I disagree with Mr. Bopp on so many levels, I appreciate that we're actually having a discussion, right? We're having a discourse here. We're going back and forth. This is what political discourse and debate would actually look like. If you allowed somebody who vehemently disagreed with one another and actually engaged that, then you would actually have some debate and discourse, and I think we would elevate the discourse of this country. But those political ads are not that. They're warm, fuzzy bits of nonsense, and most of the American people know it.
Jim?
Politicians win elections because they get the most votes. They get the most votes because they have the most support. Support is measured. I know it sounds kind of simplistic, but I think it's necessary, perhaps, to get this basic, because there's a lot of forms of support. An important one is money, and so money is a key indicator of support. In other words, the more people that are supporting your candidacy, the more people that would be willing to contribute to you. So,
Spanish.
It's, you know, there's no question that, money in politics is used for communication, almost 100% of it is used for some form of communication. It is protected under the First Amendment. Now, there's been studies on this. That one of the most interesting one I just found, because it's so contrary to the urban legends we hear so much these days. But there was a study done that since 2002, there were 263 congressional candidates that ran in at least one of those elections that spent more than $500,000 on his or her own campaign. So these were 263 rich people that if the everything that we've been hearing from the other side is true, what do you predict their election rate was? 100%? 90%? Come on, we kind of had a rally going here. How about 80%? Okay, let's say 16%. 16% of the people who spent more than $500,000 on their own campaign won, 84% lost.
Okay.
So what that tells you is you can have the money, but that doesn't mean that you've got the support and that votes trump the money.
Okay. Thank you.
Are we going back and forth?
That's right. You start. You've already talked about this one, right? Excuse me. Before we go to the next question, if you want to start passing your index cards toward the aisle, we'll start collecting those for the public questions then, too. So just pass them to the nearest aisle, and we'll have somebody on each aisle collect. Our next question is from Samantha Von Endy, who is... President of the American Constitution Society, a law student here, originally from Kansas City. Sam.
Thank you. So my question for both of you is what you both think the proper rules for disclosure would be for advocacy organizations?
I think that advocacy organizations ought to report their political activity, but properly defined. In other words, that activity that is... undeniably campaign related, because as I've already mentioned, there's practically anything an advocacy group would do or could do can influence an election, because what they're doing is talking about political issues, you know, governmental issues. So anything that they do can influence an election. But if you define it that broadly, then you're now regulating them because they're lobbying, like this group is lobbying. This is not a PAC. This is an advocacy group that probably doesn't report anything in terms of campaign finance laws, any of their activity, because none of their activity is unambiguously campaign related. So if you contribute to a candidate, then the group ought to be reported that they made the contribution. and if they, or to a PAC or to a political party, or if they expressly advocate the election or defeat of a candidate, that's unambiguously campaign related. That can be reported. It is currently reported, and including the donors that gave money for the purpose of that particular expenditure. So now, there's no question this leaves out, let me just emphasize, this leaves, quote, out all sorts of activity that influences an election. There's no question it does. But see, all that rest of that activity is necessary for us to do the other things that we want to do with respect to the government. We want the government to pass an amendment. Well, we've got to meet here and talk about it and praise or criticize governmental officials. If you go on their website, there are they praise or criticize governmental officials, current U.S. senators, for various amendments that they've submitted, and most of the amendments they found to be wanting. Well, that you know, some of you that really like their amendment, and then see this other senator wants a weaker version, well, you know, that may mean you won't support him. So, you know, anything you do can influence an election. But for us to talk about the government, talk to fellow citizens about the government, have this an exercise of self-government, and lobby the government, then we have to be able to do these things about issues.
Okay. David.
So I can get us some time back, all of it.
Yeah. No,
all of it. I appreciate the precision of your question, and I want to answer it very specifically. I think all of it, but that's a political question, right? How much we should allow either a for-profit or a non-profit or any kind of campaign financing of any variety, these are political questions, and they should be discussed and debated. And whether I agree with it or disagree with it, it's not a constitutional law question. But you've asked me a political question. I think all of it should be reported. I am a believer in 100% full disclosure of expenditures, period, end of story. That's what I would actually like to see the law be.
Our last question by the oldest looking student on the panel. George Rary, who is with a Move to Amend of South Central Indiana. George.
Thank you. I have to say that the more that I hear Mr. Bopp talk about corporations, the more I think he's talking about people. And I mean, I'm almost confused now as to the difference in your mind of what the difference is between a corporation and people, because you've used it so interchangeably, feelings, emotions, that it's confusing me. But anyway, my question is that the Supreme Court ruled on this idea in Citizens United about corporations being people. How did the justices know what the founders' intent would be, since it's not mentioned anywhere in the Constitution? The word corporation is not mentioned anywhere in the Constitution.
Well, first, your confusion about my position may relate to whether or not you understand what the word collection or association means. A corporation is an association of people. It's more than one person. It's a group of people that come together for a particular purpose. You know, it could be a girls' softball league. You know, it could be because they want to, you know, make computers. It could be because they're running a gas station. So it's a collection of people that come together for a specific purpose. Advocacy groups like this corporation or Dawn's, come together to advocate certain political ideas. So it's a collection of people. So it's not purely, you know, a natural person, obviously, because it's a collection of people for a particular purpose. But it's still a collection of people, you know, who have rights, who have a right to associate under the First Amendment. That right of association for political purposes is itself protected. In other words, he's really wrong when he says it's a political question on what not-for-profits can be required to report. It's not. It's a First Amendment question that the Supreme Court in 1949, when the state of Alabama wanted the membership list of the NAACP that was leading the boycott in Birmingham, Alabama, of the white businesses, and they wanted the supporters of the NAACP, you think to send them a birthday card? No. The Supreme Court knew exactly what was up. That was to suppress that organization. So, it goes New York Times versus Sullivan, NAACP, where the court is protecting associations, groups of people who are exercising First Amendment rights. And the First Amendment right doesn't have the word person in it. It protects, as I mentioned before, the First Amendment does not have the word person in it. Congress shall make no law abridging the freedom of speech. It doesn't say person. It doesn't say illegal aliens. It doesn't say children. It says speech. So anybody that can speak, that amendment protects.
Okay. So I'm going to again return to William Rehnquist because I think his opinion in Pacific Gas versus Electric Company really sums it up. He said, extension of the individual freedom of conscious decisions to business corporation strains the rationale of those cases beyond the breaking point. To ascribe to artificial entities an intellect or mind for freedom of conscious purposes is to confuse metaphor with reality. And with all due respect to Mr. Bopp, he is confusing metaphor with reality. The artificial entity known as a corporation is created under state law through a chartering process, a limited liability. This is a privilege, not a right. Every first-year law school student is taught this notion. So there are no inherent and inalienable constitutional rights. I also think it was an adroit effort to fail to observe that the word corporation isn't used in the Constitution by the founders. That might suggest to us that the founders did not expect the corporation to play any meaningful role in the body politic. Again, I think as a matter of founders' original intent, it's very clear that the idea that corporations would have constitutional rights was nowhere in their mind whatsoever.
Okay. Well, thank you to all the panel for your questions. I'll now take as many of the audience questions as we can get to. Maybe we can try shorter answers with each of these.
You bet.
Dissenting opinion of Justice Stevens makes the very practical point that Citizens United had other legal ways to use these funds, such as through its political action committee, so that any claim that its free expression rights were being restricted is an overstatement. Congress had a very liberal and inclusive set of associational options for tax-exempt organizations, more than 30. Why not look at Citizens United basically saying you could have used your money in a PAC? Either of you, 30, 60 seconds.
Well, the court has long ago, when we had liberals on the court that didn't just believe in nude dancing in the First Amendment, but also believed in political speech being protected by the First Amendment, held that you could not require, the government could not require somebody to speak in a certain way. In other words, that it wasn't the government's decision what vehicle, what mode or mechanism somebody was going to choose to speak, but it was up to the individual. That's part of the freedom to speak, is you choose, you know, how you're going to speak, in what way, using what methodology or whatever the case may be. So, that was really an easy no-brainer. Yep. for the court because it's so long held that the government does not have the right to decide that for somebody to do something one way when they want to speak another.
And of course, what I would say is quite simply, the court overturned 100 years of precedent around campaign finance law. And that's the reason that you're seeing such an uproar amongst the American people and amongst political scientists and law school professors all across this country. I mean, the Citizens United, we have to understand and remember, what did Citizens United versus FEC do? It overturned the McCain-Feingold law. Remember John McCain, Republican, Russ Feingold, Democrat? One of a bipartisan agreement around campaign finance contributions that was actually quite flimsy. I mean, billions of dollars were still flowing, and the Supreme Court decided that there wasn't enough money in our elections, and so they literally opened the floodgates around what Citizens United actually did. I think that we have to really come to terms with what that decision really did and how we are the reason that we, the people, are losing confidence in the integrity of our own election process. This is dangerous.
A lot of these, a lot of questions are addressed to one or the other, so I'll try to alternate those, but let the other one comment on it as well. To David, you use the term judicial activism to describe Citizens United. Are you suggesting that judicial decisions you like are not judicial activism?
Absolutely not, and I thought I made it clear, and thank you for actually bringing it up. Judicial activism occurs anytime the court overturns a legislative decision. That is the definition of judicial activism. And the only time that the court should overturn a political decision is if there is a clear and unambiguous finding that that legislation actually infringes upon a human being's constitutional rights. But that is still judicial activism, but it's the only time that judicial activism is actually appropriate in a democratic republican form of government.
Jim, what do you think of judicial activism?
Oh, it's very evil, and I also don't define it the way he did either. I do think the Constitution actually has substance. In other words, it has things like you have to be 35 years old to run for U.S. Senate or for the president.
Only 30 for Senate, actually.
30% for Senate, 35?
For
president,
okay,
thank
yeah.
you.
Okay.
Never had to consult it on either, for either purpose. I see that you have, though, Paul.
Yeah, okay.
It has actual substance, and so it couldn't be said that it's judicial activism when you're faithfully interpreting and applying the Constitution as far as its substantive results. So it's not judicial activism to strike down a law that would allow somebody to run for president that was 32 years old. That's not judicial activism. That's just faithfulness to the Constitution. What is judicial activism? It is when it's contrary or to the Constitution. It either, adding rights into the Constitution that aren't there, or taking rights and diminishing them despite their plain language and the intent of the founders. Now, of course, that's a subject of debate, right? And he's debating it, and I'm debating it, what the First Amendment even says. It doesn't have corporations in it or people at all, what it says and what it means. But that's the proper debate. If a law does abridge the freedom of speech, this should be struck down. That's not judicial activism.
Okay. Next question, how does the individual compete with the dollars when it comes to a citizen's voice? This is from a veteran teacher. My voice in decision-making has been quieted by state legislation written by ALEC and funded by corporations, as well as at the local and building level. You are arguing on the national level, and the impact is on the individual level. How can I be heard against the background of monies from people who do not have a personal stake in education, but just a moneyed interest?
I suppose that's to me. Your challenge is the fact that if you like wanted to run for Congress, there's 600 and some thousand people in an average congressional district in Indiana, and you have to be able to communicate to them. You have to get support so that other people will communicate on your behalf, or support in terms of money in order for you to communicate. Now, one of the big problems we have in our campaign finance right now is contribution limits. Contributions to federal candidates are limited to $2,600 per election, except if you're rich. And if you're rich, you can spend, as I've already mentioned, hundreds of thousands or millions of dollars of your own money. And then if you're an incumbent, of course, have already won, already have your donor lists and all the free media and everything, you know, the incumbent has enormous advantage, the rich person has enormous advantage, the person of average means, has, in order to pool resources now, get resources from other people, you know, they can't have somebody write them a big check because of contribution limits. I think that's wrong. I think that people of average means ought to be able to run and that you and have somebody else contribute to your campaign. Not just say, well, you can, you know, rich people can spend their own money and have that inherent advantage and not be able to contribute it to people of average means who don't have the money.
David?
Short answer, of course, what almost all of us, I think, agree with the questioner is that your voice is, in fact, drowned out. And we know it. We know that. And in fact, I submit to you that campaign financing is becoming the civil rights issue of this era, because our rights as citizens to be able to participate in the process, do you know that it is less than 0.5% that is actually responsible for over 80% of the funding of all of the elections? Look at the small number of people who are literally controlling the political narrative and discussion in this country. That's the reason why majoritarian issues are not actually public policy in this country, because we have become an oligarchy. We're not a democratic republic. We're an oligarchy. A ruling elite are in charge of this country, and most of us know that. And my challenge to you is, what are we going to do about it? So I'm glad that you're here at this debate. I think it's fantastic. I'm glad we're having this discourse and debate. We clearly have some disagreement. I think he's a nice fellow, by the way, and I mean that sincerely. Like, I really mean that. Like, I think it's important that we know how to politically disagree and do it vigorously and robustly. And at the end of the day, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to go across there, shake the man's hand, and I bet you a dollar to a donut he shakes mine too. Right? That's really important, that we understand that we can have rigorous debate and discourse and still be agreeable to one another as human beings. But let's be clear, the discourse is not happening because it has just become an auction and the wealthy have taken control of the political process.
This question's mainly addressed to David. How would you protect the rights of members of Move to Amend or the American Constitution Society and other not-for-profit advocacy groups under your proposed amendment and your approach? Aren't for-profit corporations different than not-for-profits?
Great question, and I genuinely thank you for this, because it really gets to the essence and the substance of it. First of all, the very last part, aren't they different? Yes, of course they're different. For-profit corporations are different than nonprofit corporations, and they're treated differently under law, right? I mean, there are all sorts of things that nonprofits simply cannot do. There are all sorts of things that for-profit corporations can do. This is very basic. So absolutely, yes. But now let's get to the meat, the essence of the question. How would I propose to be able to protect the rights of the members of Move to Amend? The same way that the court did in NAACP versus Button, which Mr. Bopp actually referenced, because this is an important issue. The state of Alabama was going after NAACP rules, to be sure. And when you read that decision, and I hope that you will read the decision, it was very clear. The court said not that the NAACP as an entity had any rights at all. It said the rights of the people to assemble into the NAACP was being threatened by a legislative action. So another example, it was judicial activism, because it went in and said that is an illegitimate exercise of the police state or the police power or of the state government in order to actually ask for those lists, because it violated the individual rights. Move to Amend's members have individual rights. The American Constitution Society has members have individual rights. And it may well be that there are times when the American Constitution Society or Move to Amend or the NRA or any other nonprofit is the right entity for standing purposes to assert and defend those rights. But do not confuse the NRA or the American Constitution Society or Move to Amend as somehow poof being created consciousness and any constitutional rights as the artificial entity. People have rights.
Jim.
According to their amendment, artificial entities established by the laws of any state, the United States, or any foreign state shall have no rights under the Constitution. So that's just all BS, honestly. There is nothing in the amendment that would provide for the protection of members of the NAACP. And the NAACP, and now he's not going to like me because I'm not nice, but the NAACP is a corporation. You know, my law firm's a corporation. Does that mean that I ought to be subject to unreasonable searches and seizures or cruel and unusual punishment? Or, I mean, no, I shouldn't have due process? Or how about, am I not protected by equal protection of the law because I'm associating with other lawyers to engage in the practice of law and I've incorporated? I mean, no, nobody would want to live in a country like that, at least one where we take freedoms and rights seriously. And so this artificial distinction, I mean, he was talking about a corporation is a charter. Well, if that's all you got is a charter, you ain't got nothing. And, you know, I've got files of charters in my law firm. And that's because there are no people that came together to associate, to give life to that charter, to that group. Because its inherent nature is as an association of people working together for a particular purpose. So it's not some mystical entity out there, some piece of paper that has magical powers. Without people, it's nothing. And and that's the way it ought to be viewed.
I still like you. I just don't think you understand standing.
Okay. Let me, enough of the feel-good stuff.
There's nothing about standing in your amendment.
A lot of folks think Washington is broken. A lot of people think government is broken. A lot of people are suspicious of any attempts to fix it. What can we do to fix Washington? Jim.
Elect a Republican Senate and get rid of Barack Obama. Yeah.
David?
That's a simple and short answer. Okay.
So let me be very clear. One thing we damn sure shouldn't do is try to think that more money is going to solve that problem. Yeah. Right? Like, it's very clear that actually the only way we're going to actually solve that problem is if we do what other people have done before us, and that is to educate, to agitate, to organize. You see, we need a mass movement in this country of conscious, educated, politically aware people who are actually taking our sovereignty seriously. And that actually is what Move to Mend represents. We're ordinary people who are actually rolling up our sleeves and doing the work of the hardest thing that you can do in politics. Amending the Constitution is the single most difficult thing that you can do in politics. So I say with candor just very sincerely, I think one of the things you can do, not the only thing, that one of the things you can do is join Move to Mend and let's take our country back.
Hey, could I reclaim my other 23 seconds?
Pardon?
Okay. Actually, I do have a serious answer to the question. And I do agree with what David just said about money's not the answer. Barack Obama added $1 trillion to every budget that we've had since he's in office, and it's all come into the by debt for all your children.
Yeah, I hope you enjoy focusing on fixing Washington.
Okay. So I agree with him about the money won't fix the problems. But I think the essential problem that we have is government has too much power. And people are alienated because all these decisions are being made, and now more decisions, your health care, seventh of the economy is taken over.
Okay.
So,
government's too big.
Now all these decisions are going to be made.
I want to try to get a couple more questions in before we go to closings. A couple combined here. Basically, do you believe there's any risk of politicians being bought by foreign corporations or governments? Somebody else says, corporation that's a group of, say, Chinese and American shareholders gives money to a candidate. Do the Chinese shareholders have free speech rights to influence our election? So foreign influence in elections.
All of those contributions are illegal under current law, and that was upheld by the United States Supreme Court after Citizens United. And I think it's an appropriate limitation that we should not have the Chinese Communist government or the Red Chinese Army or whatever participating in our elections.
The reality is that the U.S. Chamber of Commerce clearly actually had a program to allow international corporations to actually funnel money through the political process. It's called dark money. It's happening right now, and the Citizens United decision actually facilitated that. We should just be clear about that.
One last question. Congress, I think, as Jim pointed out, was voting on something either tonight or tomorrow. There's a Senate Joint Resolution 19. There's a couple other House resolutions. In addition, there are a couple other groups that are pushing similar issues to this. Somebody mentioned the name on one of their questions. Wolf something or what? You know, there's other Wolf Pack. To David, are you working with other groups? Do you support these resolutions? And to Jim, is there anything that's being suggested that you might be supporting that's coming out in Washington?
All right, so first of all, I want to say that Move to Mend works with a wide variety of people on a number of issues. We're working with Hip Hop Congress. We're working with the Pachamama Alliance. I give presentations at John Birch Society meetings and Tea Party groups, for real. And I actually make the case, right? So we're working with a wide number of people. Now, we don't support Senate Joint Resolution 19 because it is very narrow and it would only actually deal with campaign finance law. It would not address corporate constitutional rights. We think that we need a mass movement to make it clear that only human beings have inherent and inalienable constitutional rights and that money is not speech. So that's the only amendment that we will support. You see, we believe we're only going to get one bite at this amendment apple. This is the movement moment, and we're actually having a discussion and a debate about what the movement is for. So we are very clear that Move to Mend will only support an amendment that actually does those two things. There are other groups that disagree with us. That's fine. So we'll work with them when we can, and we won't work with them when we can't. So it's just that simple. So at the end of the day, that's the distinction of when we'll work with people and when we don't. And we're very candid about that. It's all over our website. We're very clear about what we're for.
I predict that this whole effort to amend the Constitution to gut its core provision, which is protection of political speech, has no legs and will go nowhere. So I don't think his organization will get even one bite at the apple. And because at the end of the day, people do like to use these issues for partisan political purposes. And there's no question that's happened on both sides of the aisle. But at the end of the day, most people understand that if you cede to the government the power to decide when you can criticize the government, when you can assemble, what issues you can talk about, when you can support candidates or not support candidates, that a fundamental change will have happened in our society, and we will no longer be a government of self-government and freedom, but just another old, tired, socialist dictatorship. And, that wouldn't be no fun for anybody.
Okay. The time for closings. Let's take 2 minutes, two and a half minutes for each closing. You're welcome to come down here. And the way we selected it, Jim goes first.
Oh,
I think, didn't we? That's how we slid it. Jim goes first, Dave goes second.
Oh, that's right. I'm sorry.
Do it from up there or down here?
I'll just go ahead and do
okay.
It here since I'm not ready.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
Although, yeah.
I think I was trying to sum up the answer to last question because I forgot about the rebuttal.
Okay.
But I do think passage of an amendment like this, seceding to government, the total authority to prohibit anyone from doing anything that would in any way influence an election, ceding government that authority is quite profound. And it's interesting that so much of the impetus for this seems to come from people that are critical of the government. So if you're critical of the government, but you want to give them the power to decide whether or not you can attend this meeting, that you can come together and support that group, or that group can communicate to the Congress what your views are about this amendment, I'm stumped by that thought, because I don't trust the government, whether it's conservative hands or liberal hands. I don't trust it no matter what, because the government, people are human, They don't like to be criticized. That's the bottom line. They will use the government to stop you if they can. And that's just the nature of the beast that we're dealing with. That was a fundamental understanding of the founders when they said that these fundamental democratic freedoms were guaranteed by the First Amendment so that the government wouldn't attack your ability to speak out about the government. There's one thing that hasn't come up today, which I thought found to be really interesting, kind of in general about campaign finance, and that is there's been a lot of rhetoric about the relationship between money and campaigns and thereby whether or not a government is considered corrupt or politicians are corrupt or they get too much money and they're considered corrupt. One of the best studies that has been done on this very question compared first the best governed, and you just have to look at the study, see if you agree with their criteria, identified the 10 best governed states in our union and found that 7 of them had no contribution limits. In other words, the rich person could come along and give the most all the money, which I think is a good system. All right? And Indiana has that system. So you don't have to be, to run, you don't have to be rich, you know? So, because people can contribute to you. Now, they also looked at another index.
Time to wrap up then.
The inverse, yeah. Which is the most and least corrupt by looking at convictions for public corruption. They found that of the 10 least corrupt, 4 of them had unlimited contributions. In other words, there was just simply no relationship between how well-governed you are or how honest your politicians are by campaign finance. It's a fool's errand to pursue these kinds of laws to think that you're going to make somebody not corrupt who's otherwise corrupt.
Thank you, Jim.
So I want to thank Mr. Bopp for engaging in a vigorous, robust political discussion. But I'm going to take on head on the question of, does this issue have political legs? That's how I'm going to conclude, because I'm going to tell you something. Move to Mend was 12 people in a living room in 2010. Today, we are 367,000 people and growing every day. We have 125 local affiliates, like the one here in Bloomington, and more coming online every day. Ordinary citizens joining this effort. We've helped 600 communities pass resolutions of support for Move to Mend at the city council or the county government level. And more than that, we've put it on the ballot 200 times, not just city council members and county commissioners voting, but ordinary citizens getting an opportunity to vote on whether or not they support the abolition of corporate constitutional rights and money of speech. 200 times we've been on the ballot. Anybody want to guess how many times we've won? 200. We haven't lost yet. And I want to be clear, friends. This, yes, it includes San Francisco and Madison and Boston, you know, the liberal bastions. You know where else it includes? Waukesha, Wisconsin, hometown of Republican Tea Party Governor Scott Walker, where they haven't voted for a Democrat for president or Congress in over 50 years. Move to Amend was on the ballot and we won. Move to Amend was on the ballot in Salt Lake City, Utah. Most importantly, I think we've won in places time and time again where Republicans outnumber Democrats or Greens or Independents. And the one I really want to underscore is a statewide initiative on the state of Montana. Now, does anybody want to argue that Montana has been taken over by a bunch of liberal hippies? No? All right. We know the culture politically. We know what Montana is. Montana, in November of 2012, in the same election where they were overwhelmingly voting for Mitt Romney for president, Montana had this on its ballot. a ballot question to declare the policy of Montana as follows. Number one, political spending may be regulated in order to defend the integrity of elections, prevent corruption, and to defend the political equality of all Americans. And two, corporations do not have constitutional rights of human beings, but rather have the rights of obligations of state corporation laws. Friends, that was on the ballot in November of 2012 while they were voting for Mitt Romney. 75% of Montanans voted in favor of that that proposal. This is cutting across political boundaries. Democrats, Republicans, Greens, Libertarians, Independents, Liberals, Conservatives, Moderates alike, this is actually United Citizens. And that's, again, I'm going to repeat it. Citizens United versus FEC did do one thing. It united the citizens in a way I haven't seen anything done before. Peace.
Round of applause again for the speakers, the panelists, and the law students. And we have food outside. Thank you for joining us. Food outside.